Well, hello everybody, and welcome back to the fourth session of today's stakeholder event. Firstly, thank you very much to everybody who's joining today, and for those of you who have been here all day, well done for staying the course. I'm delighted that you're here to hear from this final session. My name's Mike Robling, and I'm the Director of the Division of Population Health Trials within the Centre, and of also of relevance to this particular presentation or set, series of presentations, I'm also the directorial lead for routine data. This session is also going to be co-chaired by Dr. Rebecca Cannings-John, who's a senior research fellow in statistics within the centre, and she will be helping field and pose some of the questions at the end of the session. So please to ask questions using the Q&A function as we're going through, and we'll hopefully have sufficient time to ask those questions at the end. But firstly, I want to hand over to a presentation from the Chief Medical Officer for Wales, Dr. Frank Atherton, which has been pre-recorded. And if you are happy to run that, and then I'll pick up with the formal session introduction after that. Okay, and so my thanks to Frank for providing that really important national context and the views of the Welsh Government about the centrality and importance of using existing data, whether that's routine or collected prospectively in trials, and how they have supported the clinical research infrastructure to make best use of those data sources. I'd also like to, in introducing the session, talk a little bit about, provide a little bit of personal context. So when I was a very junior research assistant many years ago, and before I entered the world of trials, I worked on a study which was designing and implementing an audit system for diabetes care in Cardiff and the Vale of Glamorgan, which meant I designed a system to collect data from individual GP practices. Data was assisted on pieces of paper. This was well before fully established network computing, and was then used by GPs to improve the services they provide to their practices, to the patients with diabetes in their practices. And I think as a researcher, this demonstrated to me the real value of the data that existed already in patient notes, in other sources, and how that could be used immediately to improve services for patients, but also how it could then form the basis of research projects. And also as a patient as well, because I am a person with diabetes, and I was designing a system to collect data, including my own. And it made me, I think, really empathize with the importance of this data that we're using, we're referring to now, to individual patients and members of the public. And it has meaning to them when we look at people's blood pressure, their blood glucose scores, their weight. And as researchers, we have a real responsibility to treat those data with respect and to make the best use of it. So by existing data, we're talking about data which is generated when providing services to the public, or as part of a research project. This is a valuable resource for research because it allows us, amongst other things, to more fully complete follow-up for patients in studies. It actually reduces the burden to patients because we're not asking them again for data that is already existing records. It can do so at reduced cost and also in some cases better quality. And as trialists, I guess our questions are, how do we make best use of these resources in a way that's consistent with the ambitions of both the Welsh Government and also us as a trials unit? You know, it's one of our strategic aims is to make best use of existing data. How do we do so whilst respecting the rights of patients and the public themselves? Patients are key beneficiaries of our research, but they are also important research partners in the work that we do. How do we involve them more fully in work that involves routine or existing data? And how can we do so in a way that comfortably fits within the legal framework within the UK? And a framework which may also differ between countries within the UK. So in our free presentations this afternoon, we're going to be looking at different ways in which the challenge of using existing data is played out in individual studies. And I'd like to invite firstly Becca Milton, who's a research associate and study manager within the centre, talk about an observational study which is using and also supplementing data which is captured routinely in maternity units across the UK to answer questions about the safety, the relative safety of giving birth underwater for mothers and babies using birthing pools. So I'd like to hand over now to Becca.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to share my screen now, so just give me a second. Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. My name is Rebecca Milton, and as Mike said, I'm a research associate here at the Centre for Trials Research, and I'm the study manager for the pool study. The title of my presentation this afternoon is Water Births, Topping Up Routine Data for Research Use. So I expect most people know somebody or have had or know someone who's planning a water birth. And I also expect that everybody listening on this call also has some sort of opinion about delivering babies underwater. Water births are common and they're becoming increasingly more popular. Up to 50,000 births per year in the UK, which makes up 7% of our total UK births, are actually water births. Water immersion for pain relief in labour has been recommended by NICE since 2007. And you'll know that if you've had a baby and you start to go into labour, that the midwife is most likely to tell you to take a bath, to relax. So this is ongoing and it's common practice. However, at the moment, we need to inform women that there is insufficient high quality evidence to either support or discourage giving birth in water. So therefore, the aim of the pool study is to fill in this research void and to establish the safety of water births. The gold standard approach here would have been a randomised control trial, which would have given high quality evidence around risks and benefits of water birth compared to land birth. However, there's two reasons why this can't be conducted. Firstly, the number of participants needed, and secondly, that water births have already been in place for some time, so therefore there's a lack of impartiality and strongly held opinions from patients and healthcare providers. So this is the portrayal of water birth in the media. I spent some time scouring the internet for various headlines on water births, and everything that comes up is negative. I found quite a lot of positive and wholesome stories on social media, but anything that's in the mainstream media is all quite negative. The headlines are all definitely all focusing on really adverse effects. So these are the study objectives. So our primary objectives are to establish whether for low risk women who use a pool during labour, water birth compared to leaving a pool prior to birth is as safe for mothers and infants. Our secondary objectives are to describe the overall proportion and characteristics of women who use a pool for labour or birth compared to those who don't. Characteristics of and outcomes for women with identified risk factors at labour onset who use a pool during labour. And the characteristics of and outcomes for women who develop labour complications who use a pool during labour. And factors associated with high and low rates of pool use in individual maternity units. The study outcomes, they're split across maternal and infant. So just focusing on the maternal primary outcome is obstetric anal sphincter injuries. And the secondary outcomes is split between intrapartum and postnatal, so throughout delivery and afterwards. So in the intrapartum phase, we've got shoulder dystocia and required management of the third stage of labour, placenta, whether that was delivered in the water or not, and whether that was intended or not. the need and reason for obstetric involvement in women's care, including sepsis, maternal position at birth, treatment for hemorrhage, and incidence and management of perineal and other genital trauma, and the postnatal secondary outcomes for the mothers, duration of postnatal stay, breastfeeding, higher level care, and maternal readmission to hospital within 7 days of delivery. Moving on to the infant outcomes. So the primary outcomes for the infants, a composite of adverse infant outcomes or treatment, which include neonatal unit admission requiring respiratory support, antibiotic administration within 48 hours of birth. This is both with and without culture-proven infection. Intrapartum stillbirth or infant death. And the secondary outcomes, timing of cord clamping, Apgar scores, resuscitation, and the cause of intrapartum stillbirth or infant death. So moving on to data and deliveries. So for every birth and every baby, staff enter so much data. There's up to 176 data points per delivery. And for the pool study to be properly established, the safety of water births to properly establish the safety of water births for mothers and their babies, we had to add in only an additional 16 data points, and this is to the already established maternity software system, which is hosted by Wellbeing Software. So we've been working with Wellbeing Software, who provide 35 NHS sites across the UK with their maternity software systems. So this slide shows our data collection and extraction timeline. So the benefit of using routine data in the pool study means that we can start collecting data from a historic time point. The study opened in 2018, yet for participating sites and those that were established with Wellbeing Software in 2015, under a special approval where we didn't need to obtain consent from the mothers, we're able to use data which has been collected since 2015. So this data wasn't identifiable, but it will contribute to the sample size required to power the study. In order to meet all the study outcomes, we needed to add in some additional questions into the maternity software. And from the point of sites going live, there's an option for the mother to opt out of the study. And the quantity of the data we'll get from this approach is cost effective, and it reduces the burden on both patients and healthcare workers. So this slide shows the size of the sample that we need to get the answers for this study. So the overall data set needs 600,000 women, and these 600,000 records will form the denominator and are required to describe the proportion of women who use a pool during labour and how their characteristics compared to women who didn't use a pool. To answer the maternal primary outcome question, we need 30,000 women to have used a pool in labour and who meet the NICE criteria for being low risk. And we need 15,000 of those women to stay in the pool for delivery. To answer the neonatal primary outcome questions, we require a smaller sample size of 16,200 infants. And that includes 8,100 babies to be born into water. And as some of the data items are not currently collected, this will need to be informed by data relating between births when the site opens and the end of the study. So these are some of the benefits of using routine data for the pool study. So we've got a combination of both retrospective and prospective data. It's a reduced burden for participants, researchers, and healthcare workers because they're not re-entering data that's already been collected. We're managing to get 6 years worth of data in a 3-year study, so it's cost effective. The ability to include a very large number of participants. And this study also provides a snapshot of the UK. So the NHS sites that are included in the Wellbeing Software system are actually really well distributed across the country. Midwives have not found the additional fields laborious or challenging at all. In fact, they've given us positive feedback. And when using routine data, it's often a you get what you're given situation. You manage the data that comes to you. But we've designed the pool study to enable and it's enabled the research team to use the routine data, add in the new variables into an existing system to help us answer these really important research questions. I'd just like to take the time to thank everybody on this acknowledgement slide. And if you've got any questions, I think they're going to go into the chat box and will be answered at the end of the session. And I think I'm handing over to Yvonne Moriarty now. So thank you all so much for your time.
Thank you, Becca. Yes, so our next speaker will be Yvonne Moriarty, who is a research associate working in the centre, and is going to be describing a very exciting study which has kicked off over the course of this summer, and I think demonstrates the importance and the utility of having a trials unit which already works in partnership very effectively with other parts of the research infrastructure within Wales and also with locally based academics, and to answer key questions which have been thrown up as part of the COVID pandemic. In this case, the issue of the secondary consequences of the pandemic for cancer symptom awareness and presentation in primary care. So Yvonne, over to you.
Thank you very much, Mike. Sorry, I'm just sharing my screen. I'm hoping you can see my slides. So it does, yes. Okay. So as Mike said, I'm going to be talking about the Cancer Awareness and Attitudes and Behaviours study. So this was funded by the UKRI as a rapid call in response to the COVID pandemic. And before I start off talking about the, I just want to check you can see my slides, but I've got two screens. I'm not sure it's on the right screen.
You might need to move presentation mode, Yvonne.
Sorry, I just stopped sharing my screen. Right, is that, hopefully that's better. Can you see it now, Mike?
Not yet.
Sorry, Mike. My screen seems to have frozen. Sorry, Mike.
Okay, well, if you come out and then we can actually move on to Kate, if that's okay, whilst you try and reload your presentation. Is that okay, Yvonne?
Yeah, that's fine.
We were gonna, at the end of Yvonne's presentation, we were going to have a short presentation from Kate talking about the population health theme within the College of Biomedical and Life Sciences, within which this particular project falls as an example of some of the collaborative work that we do as a centre. So Kate, over to you.
Okay, hi everyone. Let me try and share my screen. Okay, so thank you. So I wanted to take this opportunity to kind of sneak in two or three slides really. So thank you for that opportunity. And really just to raise awareness of the population health research theme, which sits within Cardiff University's College of Biomedical and Life Sciences. And so the aim really of the theme is to provide opportunities for new population health research collaborations across the colleges and university and also beyond the university. So really what we're trying to do in this theme is to establish a community of academics from wide-ranging disciplines and areas of expertise who have common research interests in the area of population health. So our mission is to prevent ill health and improve health, reducing inequalities across the life course, by understanding the biological, the environmental, and the psychosocial causes of disease and the determinants of health risk behaviours, and to develop and evaluate interventions to improve health, to improve healthcare quality and safety, and then to use that evidence to translate into policy and practice through innovation. So the aim is to, as I mentioned earlier, is to really try and provide opportunities for new collaborations and large collaborative grants working across Cardiff University's research themes. And the population health theme consists of four sub-themes looking at health behaviour, behaviour change, healthcare quality and safety, and health across the lifespan in those different domains. So these are the people involved in the population theme. So Dr. Liba Sheeran is the research theme lead. Dr. Harry Ahmed, Dr. Catherine Purcell and me are the associate theme leads. So there's going to be a survey coming around to Cardiff University researchers shortly via their college communications team so that we can really start to map out your research interests and expertise. So please keep an eye out for that survey, and also, you know, obviously please share it with your network so that we can map out interests in the theme. But of course, anyone who's external can also be very welcome to be a member. And if you would like to receive updates and information about relevant seminars, then please contact any one of us using those email addresses that you can see. So that's all I was planning to say about population health. I don't know, Yvonne, if you've managed to screen share, but I do actually have all of the slides as part of the slides that I'm showing. So if it's helpful, I can present them and navigate you through. Depends what you want to do.
I do have them now, but happy for you to do that just in case my laptop gives up.
Okay, let's try that. I'll have to go the old fashioned way all the way back to the beginning. Should we try that? And I'll mute myself.
Yes, that's great. Thank you so much. Okay, so round two. So so I'm gonna present the CAB study, which was funded by the UKRI in response to rapid COVID call. Can you move on to the next slide, please? So to give you a little bit of a background first, before we move on to the CAB study. So over the last 10 years, there's been a large amount of international work around early detection within cancer. And that has really helped us understand what the sort of key barriers are around early presentation. So from that work, we know that, particularly in the UK, that people worry about wasting the doctor's time. And then that will put them off going to see their GP. And they also have poor recognition, particularly of vague cancer symptoms. So that could be things around weight loss, for example. And we also know from that work that there's an increase around fear of cancer and fatalism, particularly in lower socioeconomic groups. So findings from this work has been used to help us develop public health initiatives, and particularly focusing on groups where no presentation has been the case, in socioeconomic groups, for example. Can you move on the slide, please? So there's two main routes to early cancer detection, and that is through your presentation at your GP, so through primary care, or by attending cancer screening services. And we anticipate that during the pandemic that these will be affected. So we already know that there has been a reduction across England and Wales of cancer referrals as a result of the pandemic, and particularly the message that was sent out from the government around staying home, protecting the NHS and saving lives, sent out the message to people that cancer can wait, which essentially led on to the CAB study. Can you move the slide, please? So as I said, this was in response to a rapid COVID grant funded by the UKRI and led by Kate, with the aim to generate rapid evidence to inform public health interventions and essentially to encourage timely presentation within primary care, and also for people to engage in screening behaviours and also healthy lifestyle behaviours. So we have three objectives to meet that. So the first was to measure the long-term impact of COVID on cancer attitudes and people's behaviours. and then to understand what the contextual influences are on cancer attitudes during the pandemic, and lastly to assess the impact of COVID on healthcare service use and cancer outcomes, and this will be done through routine data. Can you move the slide, please? So it's a population-based survey, so we were looking to recruit around 3,500 adults across the UK over the age of 18. We have three main methods of recruitment. The first one was through our partners at Cancer Research UK, then making use of the HealthWise Wales cohort, so they're based at Cardiff University, and also through social media. And participants would complete a survey at baseline and then a follow-up survey at 6 months. And we would also plan to do some qualitative interviews. So again, these would be across two time points, so at baseline, and then we would follow up with say participants for a second interview at 6 month point. And then lastly, we wanted to, or we will be linking with routine data through SAIL. So at the moment, the plan is just to link with SAIL. However, we do have plans to link with wider UK data through NHS Digital. This is currently not part of our protocol, but we are in the process of amending this and we'll be submitting a substantial amendment to be able to do that. Can you move the slide, please? So the data we're collecting is based on a few different surveys that we've essentially put together. So the first is the CAM, which is a cancer awareness measure, which is routinely used by Cancer Research UK. Then the awareness and beliefs about cancer, and also the health behaviour study. So we're collecting a range of demographic data. So that includes age, gender, ethnicity, and symptom experience, which is our primary outcome. So this includes the type of symptom that people have experienced and the duration they've experienced it for, what their perceived severity is of that symptom, and any attribution that they have to that, and then the actual time they've taken to presentation within primary care. And this is across a range of specific and also vague symptoms. And then the same for hypothetical symptoms. So where people haven't experienced that symptom, we would ask them about hypothetical symptoms. And further secondary outcomes include symptom awareness, so their awareness around cancer symptoms, any screening behaviour they've taken part in. So that includes bowel, breast and cervical, as well as health behaviours around their diet, their exercise and smoking status. Slide, please. Thank you. So to link with the data, like I said, initially this will be through our HealthWise Wales cohort and our social media cohort and through SAIL. And we're looking to link the data over a 6 month period, so from March to September, which is essentially through the lockdown period, although the exact dates obviously of what exactly is happening are debatable. So we are also keeping a record of any local lockdowns and measures that are in place. And the kind of variables that we're looking to link are around GP referrals, particularly any tests that people have been referred for suspected cancers, their attendance at screening, so for bowel, breast and cervical, and whether they've taken part in any stop smoking services at all, and if they've had any new diagnoses, and also what stage that cancer would have been diagnosed at. And this will help us identify if there are any predictors to health service use and also the cancer outcomes. And we're particularly interested in identifying this for particular subgroups. So I should have mentioned earlier, we're also sampling particularly the Black Asian minority ethnic groups, men and smokers. So we're looking to use the routine data to help us identify whether there are any public health initiatives that can be targeted at those subgroups. Can you move the slide, please? So to give you an update on where we're at recruitment-wise, so we opened to recruitment at the beginning of August, and we've almost recruited 7,500 participants through all three of our cohorts. So like I said, I've presented some data here on our current recruitment by targeted demographics that we're targeting. So we feel that we're we're currently working on increasing our recruitment for the Black Asian minority ethnic group. But other than that group, we feel like we're doing okay with the other sampling at the moment. So, sorry, can you move the slide, Kate? So we're due to close to recruitment at the end of September for our wave one data, and then we'll be opening up again in early in the new year for wave two to collect our 6-month follow-up data. So we're in the process at the moment of identifying what our variables will be that we're planning to link within SAIL and putting together the application for SAIL, which we'll be doing by the end of the year. And also submitting the substantial amendment to allow us to collect routine data across the whole sample across the UK. Next slide, please, Kate. So this is the first study done in the UK that is explicitly looking at linking cancer attitudes and behaviours with routine data. And we do anticipate that the impact of COVID on the UK's attitude towards cancer will be significant, and particularly impacting on the NHS in terms of delayed referrals and missed screening appointments, and therefore ultimately later stage cancer diagnosis, which will impact on treatment options and overall outcome for patients' cancer. So by linking with routine data, this will allow us to assess what the longer term impacts will be of the pandemic on cancer services, which will essentially help us allow lay foundations for assessing the effectiveness of any public health initiatives, and particularly in the post-COVID era. Slide, Kate. So just a huge thank you to the study team and to acknowledge all the co-applicants. So we only opened or started the study in July. So to have recruited 7,500 participants within a 3-month period is pretty amazing. So thank you to everyone in the team. And then the final slide. So if you've got any further questions, you can use the Q&A chat, but you can also contact me directly or the CAB study team as well. And that's it from me. Thank you, Kate.
Thanks very much, both Kate and Yvonne, for that presentation. Two-handed effort. So our third speaker is Fiona Lugwidge, who is a research fellow in routine data within the Centre for Trials Research, and she's going to be talking about a range of work that we have done across a number of studies, and in particular work that touches on how we better inform the public about such work, and also how we better involve them in research that uses routine data. So Fiona, would you like to pick it up, please?
Thank you, Mike. Okay. Hi everyone. So as Mike said, I'm Fiona Lugwidge, and I am the lead for routine data in the Centre for Trials Research. So we've already heard two fantastic examples of how we as a centre and our collaborators work with administrative routine data. It's just in one sentence, I will just define what I mean by this. So these are data that are collected for administrative purposes that we then use for research purposes. So we've heard some fantastic examples of health data, but this can also include other data, so criminal justice, education, social care. So these are all considered as administrative routine data. And we have a huge portfolio of research that involves administrative data. I'll be talking about a couple of examples in more detail in a minute. So these are the projects that I could just think of off the top of my head that we currently have in our portfolio that use administrative data. But we actually use these data in different ways. So for some examples, some projects, we ask participants to consent to us to link their data. So that would be sort of consented linkage, though they would be aware of it and they would have explicitly consented. We also have a consent model that is called opt-out. And so in that sense, we are contacting individuals. They are aware that the project exists, and they have to contact the team in order to opt out. And if they don't make contact, then we would assume that they are part of that study. Another way is anonymized data. So actually, we don't know who these individuals are. We are provided with an anonymized extract, which then we work with, and that becomes our cohort. So because we have different ways of working with administrative data, that means that the way that we work with the public and have public input is going to be different. So some of our work, we have some feasibility trials going on at the moment, and we are exploring the acceptability of linkage for a future trial. So we've asked participants who are part of the feasibility trial whether, had they been asked to consent to data linkage, would they have found that acceptable? So that's, you know, that's something that we're asking at this point. So we haven't even started writing the grant, or we haven't designed that final trial, and we're already asking for input about acceptability of using administrative data. I talked a little bit about the opt-out process. So on one of our projects, we actually had our lay member train us almost on how to have a conversation with individuals who might be in contact with this, and to say that they don't want to be part of the project, they want to opt out, and how do we have that conversation with them. So in that study, it was great that we had that, we were able to have that conversation as sort of a training exercise with our lay member. When I was talking about anonymized data, it is actually up to the data provider to make the decision as to whether they release that data to us. And indeed, it is a legal requirement for them to ensure that any data that they release is of public benefit. So they have members of the public, they have lay members on their panel who help them to make that decision to ensure that the data is of public benefit. Where we've explored qualitatively barriers and facilitators to consenting and other methods of working with administrative data. And we also have we have input on also the consent material, participant information, as well as at the end when we're disseminating that, the results of the study, to ensure that we are communicating to the public, to our participants, what we plan to do and how we're going to use this administrative data. Because ultimately, you know, it's the public's data, and we're very lucky as researchers that we can work with this data, that we can use this data. And the only reason we can continue to use their data is maintaining that trust with them. So it really is important that we have these conversations throughout the life cycle of the project. So one of the examples I wanted to talk through is building blocks 2 to 6. So this is a follow-on project to a trial. So the trial ended, the intervention ended, and we continue to follow up participants, which were mothers and children, for a further 4 to 5 years. We used an opt-out model, and so rather than collecting any additional data from those individuals, we just linked to administrative data sources. So we worked with a group called Our Place, who are a group that represent a similar demographic to that trial cohort. And this is, I've got some photos here of my colleague Jeremy talking to these individuals about administrative data, about data linkage, how data moves from one place to another, how data continues to be secure. And so we've got people moving around the room, holding a string, Jeremy moving pieces of paper around. And you know, one of the main pieces of feedback that came back was, you know, wouldn't it just be easier if we had an animation rather than poor Jeremy walking around a room with pieces of paper and pieces of string. So that's what we did. So we worked with other groups. So we also worked with Alpha, and we held some meetings with them, and we talked through what we thought we wanted in animation, and they told us what they visualized and what they saw would be important images to portray in such an animation. So this was then developed into a prototype animation, which we then tested on other demographics and other groups of individuals. So this is me talking to the Healthways Wales user panel about our prototype, which was actually it was a two-tone colour, so it was white and blue. So one of the main pieces of feedback was it was very blue. But actually, other than, you know, what it looked like, we were really interested in making sure that the way that we explained about routine administrative data, the language that we used, to make sure that it was accessible to all sorts of demographics. So what we ended up with was so we had two animations that were completed at the beginning of this year, one around what is routing data, which is primarily sort of targeted for the public, and then a second animation which goes into a bit more detail about routing data and research, and it explains how researchers access data and how data can be moved around. And so although we've made sure that they're both accessible to the public, I would say the second one is probably also helpful for researchers and research sites to learn a bit more about routing data if this is a new concept to them. So this is a really, really nice example of how the idea came from the public. The imagery, the graphics, those ideas came from the public, the voiceover, the public, and finally, you know, this is targeted at the public. So a really nice sort of circular piece of work that's involved the public throughout. The other project, I'll just quickly summarise. So it's the Centric project. And so this isn't a study per se. We received funding from the Information Commissioner's Office, which is the organisation that upholds data protection in the UK. And we were funded to develop a training programme for researchers working with administrative data. So we could produce this with key stakeholders. So we worked with researchers, data providers, and the public. So we held workshops with members of the public to get their view on what would be important to include in the curriculum from their point of view. So we have six modules in this training. So this is online training curriculum, and it's just been released 1st of September. We have a module specifically for working with the public. And so once we developed a draft of this curriculum and this module, we then took that module back to the same members of the group that we'd met with earlier to see what they thought, to ensure that they were happy with what we were saying in that module. But also in other modules, such as module two, we talk about the study life cycle. And as I've explained earlier, that it's important to have that input throughout the project life cycle. It's not just at the beginning, it's not just at the end. It's making sure that individuals, the public, lay contributors, and they're all involved throughout the project. So as I said, we've just launched this training, so do please check it out. And just to end on a nice quote here, this was from our Centric workshop. So we were explaining to them about the concept of public benefit and that the data providers ensure that they have that public voice on those panels. And so this is one of our attendees saying that actually it's really nice to know that they are represented in those discussions, and it's not just the grey suits that make the decision, that actually the public are included in those decisions as well. So finally, I just want to say thank you to our funders, to all of the study team members, and from Alpha, the Healthways Wales user panel, Our Place, and CTR trial managers who also helped with the development of the animation. Thanks, everyone.
That's great. Thank you, Fiona, and thank you to all three presenters. My feed cut out partway through Fiona's talk, so but unfortunately, I'm familiar with some of the subject matter there. I'll kick off with the first question. We've got 10 minutes for questions, and then I think Becky's probably got some in hand to ask of the presenters. My question is for Becca about the pool study, and you've mentioned that the adding those 16 additional items to what was already being recorded routinely appeared to be no particular burden for the clinicians who would be collecting and inputting that data. One of the things that we're kind of interested in when using routine data is the quality of the data. You know, how well has that data been recorded at source? Can you say anything about the approach that you took to try and maintain quality of data being entered, either with those items or just overall?
Okay, so perhaps this question is a tiny bit premature for the pool study, because we're yet to receive our first data extract. But obviously we are running some sort of training session. So when we do set up a new site, we do a site initiation visit and we go through the new variables with the site. And we've worked with Cardiff and Vale Health Board to try and identify potential skips. So they were informing us of certain things where you could just enter a full stop instead of answering the question properly. So we've tried to overcome it and make sure we don't have any missing data like that. But perhaps I need another month to properly answer that question.
Okay, that's great. Thanks very much. Becky, have you got some questions for the presenters?
I do. Actually, I'm going to kick off with another one for you, Becca, because you've talked very positively about routine data and people are usually hearing a lot of negative stuff about it. But so I was wondering, you know, what have we encountered, you know, what challenges have we encountered with using that wellbeing software data and how might it differ to a standard trial?
Okay, so definitely time. I think it's taken so much more time than we anticipated in setting sites up. There's been certain things with wellbeing software which have been unexpected and that we didn't, you know, that they needed their own sort of contract with each site. Certain things that we've encountered that we would know now going forward. So we anticipated that when sites were set up with Cardiff University contracts, that would be a straightforward input of routine data, the new questions into their routine data. But it's not been that straightforward at all. So the wellbeing software team have needed their own contract. They're working with 35 different sites across the country and having to overcome their own issues, such as like old servers. It's not as straightforward as we anticipated. So they've got a number of problems that they need to encounter. And it's working with different teams as well within each NHS site. The structure isn't the same in each site. So that's been a problem. Not so much like an issue, but it's definitely added to delays, not knowing the infrastructure of each NHS site and who it is that we need to approach to get these approvals signed off. So the biggest negative I would say is time. It's taken us a lot longer than we had initially anticipated to get the site set up.
Thanks, Becca. Just looking through the questions we've had, Chris, oh, this is a question for Yvonne and possibly Kate as well, who says, great study on health behaviour and cancer. And can you say a bit more about the theoretical framework that you're using?
Kate, do you want to answer?
I'm happy to take that one. Hi, Chris. Thanks for your question. So very broadly, we'll be using the COMBI model, capability, opportunity, motivation and behaviour, as part of Susan Mickey's behaviour change wheel framework, because a lot of the work that we've done in the past, you know, suggests that cancer symptom help seeking behaviour is very much influenced by what people know or don't know and how they appraise, you know, the knowledge of cancer symptoms and how that translates into their behaviour as well as their opportunities for behaviour change. That's broadly the model that we're using.
Okay. There was another question for the Yvonne and Kate team from Karen Visser, sorry if I've got your name wrong. She says she knows the study is not complete, but what can we learn to ensure efficiency in cancer services for the future? So, for example, from the impact that COVID has had, and can this be translated to any other services to improve efficiency and attitudes in general?
Should I have a go at that? I think initially it's probably dispelling the fears around cancer. I'm not sure that's really answering the question around efficiency, but you know, we already know that a lot of people are put off going to see their GP because they're more scared of catching COVID than they are investigating any potential symptom that may be cancer. So initially I'd say we need to dispel that fear and make sure that people are accessing the support and help when they need it and present early. And so that ultimately will impact their long-term outcome.
No, that's great. And just to sort of add to what Von said, I think it's the study is really more about influences on kind of patient delay because we and referrals, because we know that you know, we've seen a huge drop in cancer referrals during the pandemic period. So we're we think that actually the kind of delays and the backlog is going to be more at the kind of public awareness end of things than cancer services per se. I think cancer services themselves have adapted very quickly to the pandemic. It's more about actually now how do we manage the backlog of people out there in the public who have perhaps been, you know, holding off going to their GP with concerning symptoms and things like that. So again, I'm not sure if that entirely answers the question about efficiency, but just to say that that's really what the study is focusing on.
Can I just ask a related question, which the study has been funded in part to have short-term policy messages, and you referred in your presentation to public health initiatives. When do you think you might realistically be able to provide something to policy based on this research?
Is that for me or Yvonne?
Either of you.
You want to have a go, Yvonne?
Yeah, I mean, that's quite a difficult question, I guess. We are constantly trying to make sure that we're staying in touch with the funders and key stakeholders to learn from the study and share our findings. It is an 18-month study, so the overarching aim is that within that 18 months we will be able to provide some kind of information, but obviously it depends what we find and how we want to take that further in terms of developing any key messages and sort of public health interventions.
Yeah, so I just had 18 months fixed in my mind for some reason. Okay, do we have further questions, Becky?
Sorry, basic error. No, there's no other questions from the Q&A. I did have one additional question for Fiona, if that's okay.
Yeah.
And then you can round off, Mike. Fi, you've done so much work over the past few years with, from building blocks, working on sort of public, getting the views over. Can you share if you've got any next steps?
That's a good question. More recently, because we've just released our centric training as part of developing the curriculum, and in particular that module 6, we had to really narrow down what we wanted to include in that curriculum in order to deliver it on time. But as you can imagine, we had discussions about, should we include this, should we include that, and we've just talked about, well, that's just got to be a version 2. And there's a huge amount of work that we want to do with public involvement in mind. We're currently developing some animations which we hope will again continue to inform researchers about how to work with the public, but I think we want to also take the next step and continue some more work with the public to ensure that they really are included and involved in the advice that we're giving to researchers, to make sure that what we're telling researchers to do, what we say is best practice, is absolutely what the public agree with. So that's definitely something that we want to be taking forward soon.
Okay, thank you very much. So thank you again to all three presenters, both for the work that you were presenting, and also for the positivity about work conducted using routine data, because often one goes to meetings when you're talking about routine data, and the tone of the conversation can often be a little bit negative, particularly in terms of how long it takes to get hold of the data. So really well done for for being so positive. I'd like now to hand over to Malcolm Mason, who I think is going to help us close the meeting.
Thank you very much, Mike. It's a real pleasure and an honour to have the opportunity to just say a few closing words. I'm sure you'll agree with me, it's been a fantastic day. I want to say that every single one of the presentations that we've had has been superb. I've learned a lot, I've got a lot of food for thought, and perhaps I thought I would just say a very few words in relation to sort of some of my immediate thoughts that have come to mind, and just to reflect on what we've heard and what we've learned during the day. So we started with the question of inclusivity. And I mean, this is an absolutely crucial issue, isn't it? Because if trial results don't reflect the population you want to apply the results to, then that's a major, major problem, and has been a major problem. It's absolutely crucial. It's crucial for us in Wales to understand specifically the effects of deprivation in all its forms on health, and also on the possible differential effects of interventions. It's completely credible that the biology of diseases is different in different groups according to deprivation as well as according to ethnicity. And I think unpicking those things is a major, major challenge ahead. And your group are well placed to address it. I would just add that, of course, as well as looking at deprived people in the community, deprived participants in trials, you're also looking at, if I can put it this way, deprived researchers, and to see research going on in areas where it's historically been very, very difficult is a real joy. And I'm referring to things like Sunita looking at studies in occupational therapy. It's great to see that. We had a session on novel trial design, which is just tremendous. I think the point has been well made that these various multi-arm studies, basket studies, have enormous advantages in terms of both their speed, in how quickly they can deliver results that can then be put into clinical practice, and their adaptability. And that's absolutely brilliant. There are some challenges which I know very well all the people who presented are aware of and working on, which are not trivial from a statistical point of view. How do you cope with the fact that your standard of care, your control arm, may change during the course of a study? Because if you show that a different intervention or an augmented intervention should be a new standard of care, that should then be implemented as the new control arm for a study. The statistical considerations of having different arms for different centres is also not trivial, but immensely solvable. One other enormous advantage of these sorts of trials which came out, which I must say I've seen and should not be minimised, is that these sorts of trials bind together research colleagues. They create their own research network, which is so important. And one of the things which I really want to see is that as these trials progress and as they conclude, that somehow we don't lose the momentum of having brought networks of investigators together from across many, many different centres and from across sometimes many countries. And indeed, one of the facets of these trials is that they do need to be very often very large and therefore international. And I really commend all of the researchers who've been working on this. And I think that the Doctis trial is a superb example of that. I really enjoyed hearing about that. It's fabulous to see the priority given to qualitative research. Hasn't it been a long road trying to get this established? And now, in a way, to me, it's come full circle, because the value of qualitative research in its own right is now something that's just not disputed any longer. But in addition to that, of course, we can now see both qualitative and quantitative research as two sides of the same coin, particularly when you see data from information from qualitative research informing quantitative research to trial design. And that is just so encouraging. And I think the examples given in the ASSIST and FRANK studies are really outstanding. Then we heard about efficiency, and perhaps it's worth reflecting that, you know, we almost take it for granted. It's not a foregone conclusion. But one of the major, major advantages of having the trials infrastructure that we have today through things like clinical trials unit really facilitates this. Actually, this wasn't always the case, not by any means. I was certainly struck by the observation that we spend up to 10 times as much time collecting secondary endpoints as we do primary outcome measures. Wow, I hadn't thought about that, but that's quite significant. As with many other areas in our working lives, I suspect that some of the changes that the coronavirus crisis have induced in trial conduct may well actually remain after the crisis is over. We may find that we've learned all sorts of things about trial conduct and design, which are far more efficient, which perhaps we wouldn't have implemented if it wasn't for that. So it would be nice to think that there will be some positives coming out of this crisis. It's really good to see the flexibility in terms of modes of follow-up. Very interesting. It's also nice to know that, at least in some circumstances, human contact is important, even if that's indirect and through Zoom. So humans haven't been completely replaced by computers yet. I thought that the concept of asking participants of their own choice of modes of follow-up was absolutely fabulous, really fascinating. And then on to the use of existing data, well, absolutely amazing. And the pool study shows just what can be done or how you can apply the rich array of existing collected routine data. And I think this is a really important consideration because you can't do randomized trials in absolutely everything. You can't answer every question with a randomized trial. We really have a duty as a scientific community to make the best possible use we have of routinely collected data. The CAB study just shows what can be done. I mean, recruiting 7,500 patients in 3 months, well, wow, is all I can say. It just shows the power of these sorts of studies. Looking at the portfolio of the studies in administrative data collection, well, fantastic. What an amazing breadth you have. I was very struck once again by seeing that the public really do care about how we do research and they really want to contribute. I think that the time is coming, and actually I think there are already examples where using this sort of administrative data may actually certainly run alongside and maybe even one day replace the use of sort of formal collections for hard clinical trial endpoints. So I think there's a lot more that's going to come there. So in summary, I really want to say congratulations to the CTR team for a superb meeting. Congratulations also, excuse my voice, for the work you do and for the impact that it has. Thank you from me to all the contributors. Thank you to everybody for participating. It's been a great day. And I think then I'll hand back to Mike and to Kerry. I don't know whether you have anything additional that you want to say, but thank you all again.
Thank you very much, Malcolm. I think it's other than to say thank you to you as well, and for your constant support from the day we were first created, when you were College Dean of Research, through to today, and for being a part of the last 5 years of our journey. Although I know you were strongly linked in with us before that as well. So it just remains for me to say thank you to everyone. For those of you who are staff of the centre, happy birthday, kind of, for last month. Hopefully, if this is successful, we might do something all again. I've certainly enjoyed it. I don't have to wish you all a safe journey home, because hopefully you're at home. So I wish you a safe journey to your kettle and to have a nice and relaxing evening. Thank you very much.